Warning, viewer discretion is advised.
Media, from books to television to movies, it's always carried a certain seriousness to it. Even with your traditional genres such as comedy, there's typically always some form of real weight driving the story forward, which, don't get me wrong, is completely fine. It's, in most cases, a necessary element to telling a story that people can engage with. But what's it like on the other side of the coin? Rebellion. Beavis and Butthead.
Why?
Because we need to evolve into dudes who score.
Yeah. Yeah, cool.
Wonder Chosen.
Give me Weenie.
Give me Chosen.
Gobble, gobble, Chauncey, no.
Tim and Eric, awesome show. These are just a few shows that capture that carefree style of not giving a shit about the right way to do things. They're crass, they're edgy, and I could talk about them all day if I really wanted to. And maybe someday I will. But for now, let's talk about one that encompasses all the traits we're after, while also incorporating a reality element into the mix. I present to you, Jackass. If you didn't know, Jackass was an early 2000s reality show that ran for 3 short seasons on the MTV channel, and later MTV2, each episode consisting of dangerous stunts, crazy antics, and of course, gross-out humor, all performed by a cast of lovable characters. Johnny Knoxville, co-creator and captain of the group.
Hi, I'm Johnny Knoxville, and this is the cup test.
Bam Margera.
I'm Bam Margera, and I feel like kicking my dad's ass all day today.
Come on, Bam.
I gotta go to work. Jerk off. Stop it.
Steve-O.
Are they biting?
Ah! Chris Pontius. Weeman. Ryan Dunn, rest in peace.
I'm Ryan Dunn. I'm about to hit some haggard backwoods crap.
Preston Lacey.
Back here.
Aaron McGee. Dave England, the resident pooper.
Hey, man. Hey. All right. You feel good now?
Yeah.
All right.
What's this?
Oh, it's poo-poo.
And several other minor reoccurring characters. There was something magical about this particular group of people. Whether it was their willingness to literally do anything or their undeniable chemistry together, they quickly charmed audiences, becoming household names in the process, and legends to viewers all around the world. The show, as you might have guessed, did super well for MTV, becoming the most successful show on the network. Yes, it did spark quite a bit of controversy with advocacy groups and the like, but that didn't stop it from becoming a long-lasting franchise, one that even saw a new film entry as of the year 2022. Indeed, most, if not everyone, knows about Jackass. But how many of you knew there was a game? Jackass the Game was released in September 2007 for the PlayStation 2 and PSP consoles, created literally 6 years after the show ended production. And even stranger, exactly 1 year after the release of Jackass No. 2 hit theaters. The company that made it, a development studio based in New Zealand, have made some, well, I don't want to say shovelware because I haven't played any of them, but come on, Barbie's Beach Adventure? Honestly, it looks like their bread and butter was rugby games, making at least 6 of them. Now, I don't know shit about rugby, My sports game of choice is boxing, so I can't really comment of the quality of these. In 2012, Sid He changed their name to Pickpock and would pretty much exclusively make iOS and Android games from then on. So where does that leave Jackass? It sits right in the middle of Sid He's very unimpressive catalog. Does it suck? And indeed, how well does it replicate the show's style of entertainment? Well, you're about to find out.
Oh man, and the idiot dropped the camera too! Thanks a lot! Jeez, it's the first day of shooting the new season and we still gotta get the other guys here, and now we need a new director because that one broke the camera! And sprained his vagina in the process.
Now we won't have to worry about him getting Aaron's mom pregnant.
So here's the deal. You're the director, find the rest of the crew, shoot some funny stuff, and don't sprain your vagina!
Well, there's our story. How do we go about finishing up this season without busting any more balls? Each episode contains a variety of mini-games that act kind of like segments from the show. And to complete them, we'll have to beat specific challenges per level. For example, being the last man standing in Bumper Kings. Or destroying two objects with one ball in Grenade Golf. Doing these raises our episode rating and lowers the required revenue needed to continue to the next section. If you're a fan of the Jackass brand, you'll be happy to know that every core character is here and will be doled out as you make your way through the season. Everyone except for Bam, who was under contract at the time with Activision for the Tony Hawk Pro Skater series. The team intended for him to be included, as we see in the unused placeholder audio on the disc, courtesy of the cutting room floor. On a positive note, the rest of the cast all came in to do voiceover for their in-game characters.
Well, hello there. I do declare this is urban wakeboarding. Yeah, I know. I mean, it's not going to get any funnier. I mean, how could it really?
Which is not super common for licensed products. Yeah, their lines during gameplay can get a little repetitive due to the small amount of lines per character. But truthfully, this was pretty common practice back in those days, mainly due to the limited space on the DVDs they had to work with, which could only hold a maximum of 4.7 gigabytes. Double that with a dual-layer disc, but let's get real. They weren't going to spend the extra money for this game. Fun fact, did you know? This is one of only four or so titles for the PlayStation 2 that supported a 1080i display mode. Now, the term HD is rarely, if ever, used to describe games of that era. But shockingly, yeah, it looks good. It's not true 1080 or anything, but clearly a nice step up from your typical PS2 game. Being released so late into the system's lifespan definitely gave them an edge in optimizing for the hardware. The motion capture was also done by the original cast, which was documented in a mostly forgotten MTV special.
We have all this technology at our disposal, and we get the entire cast out there, and we're trying to think, oh, what are we going to do now?
Spread them!
Spread out.
There are a total of 35 mini-games to complete in total. I know online it says the number is 40, but I do believe it's referring to the multiplayer mode, which I'm not going to talk about since I've always played this game solo. Honestly, single player is the main focus of the game anyway, so you're not missing much here. Right, 35 games. There's quite a large variety of experiences to try out, and I could sit and explain them all to you, but instead, I'll talk about my top 10 favorites of the bunch. Side note, the music in the game is mostly copyrighted punk music, so sorry, I can't play it.
Hi, I'm marginally talented and half interesting. The name's Ryan Dunn, and this is Big Balls. Ah! Don't ever touch me. I will kill you. Yeah, you better run.
Well, this is indeed a big ball. All right, the four of us, last man standing wins. We're pushing, we're shoving, and wow, these physics. It actually feels like we're rolling around in one of these things. Speed is what we need, but it's also our enemy. We beat these chumps. What else is there to do? Knock off one jackass with another? Come on, come on. Perfect. Get $100,000 worth of injuries. Do one lap without being hit. It's not too hard. That is, if I was doing it right. I first thought it meant do one lap around the ledge. And well, as you could imagine. Also, did you know they actually did something similar in Jackass? It wasn't on a rooftop or anything, but it was still pretty rad.
In the game, they have this thing called the big ball, and there's a few different stunts they did with it. One is you're rolling down the street in San Francisco, and we actually played with one of these big inflatable balls where you sit in the core of it. We put Pontius in the core of it. We were in Russia, and we rolled it down this super steep hill and just slammed it into Knoxville.
Hello, I'm Giant Knoxville, and this is the Cart Jam.
It's downhill domination. By the way, does anybody remember that awesome game? Anyway, we race a cart down windy, vertical city streets with nothing but a good hook to get ahead. I didn't get to use it that much, but it was honestly pretty satisfying slamming into these guys. The carts do not control like cars. You're going to want to start turning well in advance before each corner, but not too sharp, given how easy it is to turn yourself around. These may seem crappy to control, and yeah, you're right. But what did you expect? You're racing and what grannies push around on the daily. Another Jackass reference. Shopping carts are all over the franchise, including in the very first episode. We play as Steve-O, and we must tattoo Weeman. It's easy enough to stay inside the lines, that is until the motion ramps up and we have to factor in the direction the machine's going in. I make it look super easy, but I am indeed an experienced player, so...
Oh yeah, now that is a tattoo, baby!
Also, did you know that Weeman isn't playable in levels where you can choose your character? I believe it has something to do with the character model being smaller than the rest, which is why I assume he got his own exclusive minigames. He was probably too time-consuming to include in every level, so this is a good compromise.
All right, I'm Ryan Dunn, and with me is a very angry, agitated snowman, and this is called the Snow Job. With any luck, you play your cards right, bub. I'm going to turn this into yellow snow. You with me?
In Snow Job, yes, I get the pun, we play as Preston. Well, I played as Preston. I don't know. It seems like this one fit him best. We roll our human snowball down a skiing mountain, collecting everything in our path, which will grow us bigger and bigger. Better watch out for those plow trucks. The challenges are simple. Collect 6 snowboarders, destroy 4 cabins, make a 6-meter snowball. Easy peasy. Finish without colliding with anything. Now that's tough. It seems easy, but shit just keeps getting in the way. No, 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 shit!
Check it out, man. Such a sweet weenie. I'm Chris Pontius, and this is Bumper Kings. God, I have a sweet one.
Let's go. High octane bumper car action. This isn't your grandpa's bumper cars. Smash, crash. The more you hit, the more your boost meter fills up. And when it's full, boom! A glorious nitrous push off the roof. Don't get cocky though. Your opponents have the same ability. And if you miss, It's last man standing, winner take all. An intense battle to the death commences. Hell yeah! Wii Hand is a simple level wherein you play the knife game. The goal is to get a score of 150, and each stab counts as a single point. We only get 5 chances, as each mistake leaves a painful cut on Steve-O's hand, which I'm just noticing Tattoo spells out poop. It's fun as hell. I could sit and explain it to you, but what you see is what you get with this one. What you probably didn't know is the song playing during this section by Roger Allen Wade.
I ain't the sharpest knife in the drawer, but I know enough to know. If you're gonna be dumb, you gotta be tough.
Was actually produced by Knoxville himself. The more you know.
Knox had found somebody to give me a record deal. And just coincidentally, in my horoscope that day, the day I got it, it said this is the end of a 29-year low. and I got to counting, and it had been 29 years of nothing.
Oddly shaped shooting.
Oddly shaped shooting is, well, a shooting game. Weeman and Preston are jumping on a trampoline, and we're armed with a paintball gun and 60 seconds to rack up 30 points. Hitting Preston gets you 1 point, while hitting Weeman earns you 2. You're gonna wanna go for Weeman given his point advantage, but as a trade-off, he's far harder to keep track of. What we're after is the difficult to pull off nut shot. Nailing old Lacey gets you 2 points. But land a nutcracker on Wee Man will get you a total of 3 points. If you can manage to land a few of these, you'll be laughing yourself to victory.
Hello, fellas. I'm Johnny Knoxville, and this is San Fran Trash Can. I'll see you in the showers.
Jeff Tremaine, Trash Can, a heel. Let's go. If it didn't seem abundantly obvious, this stunt would have never happened. The risk of death or grave injury is just far too likely for anyone to actually attempt. Did you know? The Jackass team pitched ideas for levels based on old scrap stunts from the show and some of the movies. Given how unsafe most of these are, it's not hard to see why they didn't try. So, San Fran Trash Can, it's tough. Especially if you try the no collision challenge. Jesus, I played this stage for 30 minutes, trying over and over again. In our way are these vehicles. The first few are easy enough to memorize. Straight through, left, jump, right, left, right. But man, if you don't know which way to go...
God dang it!
We do have a speed up and slow down button. However, those will certainly not guarantee safe passage. To a viewer, this minigame might seem unfair and not worth playing. But truthfully, that couldn't be further from the truth. I was weirdly hooked while playing. Each time, I made it a little bit further. Slowly. I don't know. I just love overcoming a hard challenge. Let me know how long it takes you to beat it, if you decide to play.
I'm Chris Pontius, and we're going to be doing some urban wakeboarding. Go get him, Tiger! Woo!
I decided to put urban and suburban wakeboarding together, since they both function the same gameplay-wise, while only changing locations. I chose Steve-O, because who else would you imagine doing a stunt like this? I even selected his leopard-printed thong costume. For all you ladies out there, We skid our way through both neighborhood and the big city on a old metal trash can lid. We jump, we grind, we smash. It's super fun. Now, I am aware this wouldn't go quite as smooth as this. Hell, even Johnny Knoxville gave it a go on set.
Your ass gets a little hot.
If I haven't shown it to you before, look what happens when we get hit. These guys get messed up.
I'm Chris Pontius, and this is Pachinko Precipice. All right, buddy. It's a good day to die. See you in hell, because you're going there.
Yes, my number one favorite game of the bunch is, ironically, the first game most will play when starting the game, given it's literally the first option available. We slide down this desert mountain full of large rocks, cacti, and a couple mattresses for some reason. The movement being controlled by the L and R buttons, which not so much moves in the normal sense, but rather tilts our character from one side to the other. Our first few goals are to beat the time limit and land in the water at the bottom. Bam, bam, thank you, ma'am. Both in one go. Hit a mattress? All right. Fly 27 meters in the air before the finish? This one actually takes a bit of patience, since you can't just hit every rock you run into. You'll get no speed that way. Wait for it. Wait for it. Yeah. Yeah. That's some sick hang time. So, what do you get for completing each stage, other than simply progressing to the next minigame? Well, that could be a number of things. Whenever you beat a level, a challenge, or even move to the next episode, you could unlock one of a few things. For starters, beating a level unlocks that level in the challenge mode, which adds a completely new set of goals for that specific game. Enjoy a particular section? Well, now there's more of it to play. Costumes, of which there are several per character. I really like this Devil Pontius one right here. And of course, extra characters, like Dimitri and Jeff Tremaine. If that wasn't doing it for you, there's a shop in-game called the Jackass Mart that sell all kinds of stuff. How are you going to pay for this crap? Well, I'm glad you asked. Whenever you complete a challenge, you get cash. Alongside that, we've got the injury system, which is pretty unique and exclusive to this game as far as I've seen. Whenever your body collides with objects at high speeds or high altitudes, the game factors in the amount of damage done and pays you accordingly. It'll even spit out the details as it's happening. Which, damn, these would kill anyone altogether like that. At least, you'd figure. In most cases, the game only considers injuries when you either get knocked off or bail out of a run. And yeah, a lot of them have this button, just to press away. It's fun because you get to see crazy ragdoll impacts, and don't have to feel bad for mortally wounding these guys. Come on, they'll be fine. Alright, we got the money. What's in the shop? There's props like different balls and golf carts. Two extra playable characters, Lisa.
You are tearing me apart, Lisa!
And the attendant from the mini golf level. Jackass photos, which are just stills from the show. Some cool concept art. Segments from the TV show I unfortunately can't play you much of, but it's nice they're here. And the grand finale? The voiceover montages.
Oh, you brute! Oh, man. Hey, if you die, can I have your drums?
Hi, I'm Ryan Dunn, and I've got an extremely large overbite, and this is called making me jealous. But it feels so right.
These are all pretty funny, given how out of context they are. But the star of the show is definitely Steve-O.
Jerk! Gotta tell you guys, I'm enjoying this so much.
This was filmed during his notorious addiction to drugs.
My character just looks better than the rest.
You're a mess, dude. What the hell are you saying?
Except my character looks better than the rest. What the f*** wrong with that? Jeez.
Settle down.
Idiot.
A phase of his life he has since moved away from, being clean for 14 years as of this video. When asked about this event, Steve-O replied, "Oh my God. One of the darkest days of my addiction was in the sound studio for that video game. I think in the video game I'm like, with my nitrous oxide. It didn't even sound remotely like me. It was dark, man." So there you have it. Jackass the game and all its forgotten glory. It has such a firm hold in my memory. I remember the first time I played it. I was 15 and it was 2009, during summer break before starting high school. I would sit and play it on my little 19-inch tube TV in the evening time and dream about what this next chapter of my life would be like. It was certainly not what I pictured. And yet, I can still see that image in my mind. While sitting playing Jackass the game into the night, I was in a sort of in-between point in my life, from child to young adult. Life definitely wouldn't be becoming any easier, and yet I find comfort in this game the same as I did back in those days. Call it nostalgia if you want, which, yeah, I am very nostalgic for this game, but in truth, I honestly believe there's a good game here. Yeah, it's short, and not every minigame is a hit, but when it hits, it brings the fun. If you're a fan of the show or movies especially, don't give this one a pass. It's worth the 3 or 4 hours you'll have with it. Do yourself a favor, have fun, and stay rebellious. Have a great day.
If I had a message, it would be stay out of school. You know? Play Jackass the video game.
The video game's rad. It rules. It kicks ass. It's the best game ever. End of story.
It's the one time, kids, you can actually try it at home. Other than that, never try it at home. You know what I'm talking about.